sein, als unsere Partei gerade 7 Mann hoch war, sprach sie schon 2 Grundsätze aus. Erstens, sie wollte eine wahrhaftige Weltanschauungspartei sein. Und zweitens, sie wollte daher kompromisslos die einzige Macht und alleinige Macht in Deutschland.
This is an emergency communication from the Hawaiian Defense Headquarters. The roar of the planes you now hear is not a practice maneuver. This is not a maneuver. We're being attacked.
Senators and representatives, I have the distinguished honor of presenting the President of the United States.
Mr. Vice President, Mr. Speaker, members of the Senate, of the House of Representatives, yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy, the United States of America was suddenly and deliberately attacked by naval and air forces of the Empire of Japan. The United States was at peace with that nation, and at the solicitation of Japan, was still in conversation with its government and its emperor, looking toward the maintenance of peace in the Pacific. I believe that I interpret the will of the Congress and of the people when I assert that we will not only defend ourselves to the uttermost, but will make it very certain that this form of treachery shall never again endanger us. Hostilities exist. There is no blinking at the fact that our people, our territory, and our interests are in grave danger. With confidence in our armed forces, with the unbounding determination of our people, we will gain the inevitable triumph, so help us God. I ask that the Congress declare that since the unprovoked and dastardly attack by Japan on Sunday, December 7th, 1941, a state of war has existed between the United States and the Japanese Empire.
I'm Charles Jenkins, in Cocoa, Florida. I joined the Navy in June the 20th, 1942 in Orlando. And they took us from Orlando to Jacksonville. And we were sworn in Jacksonville about 8 o'clock at night after had a physical up there. And went from there to Norfolk, Virginia. And after we got through with that, we graduated. And I was supposed to go to Miami and go to sub chaser or PT school. And the Commander Brown never forget, he said, "Boys, I got good news and bad news. The bad news, you're not going to Miami. You're going in Phibbs." We all said, "What the heck's not like that is in Phibbs?" "I don't know, but it's something new. And God bless you." That's the initiation we got, and we got in the NFIBS. Harper got down there on Christmas Eve in 42. They didn't know what to do with us, so we had to sit on the ship all The next day, Christmas Day, they let us off and put us over in Survivor's Base. So we stayed there until we got our ship, the 344, came out of the shipyard. It was just bare. We had to borrow rope, lines we call it, to tie it up with. There wasn't nothing on it. They just run it out and floated it, and there it is, it's yours. And we put it in commission and had to take it out on time trials. We had some of the guys at Billy said, I wouldn't go across the canal in that thing. That's all the faith he had in it. So we went out on the Chesapeake Bay after we had put all the gear on it, food, stuff that was just nothing. And then we went out there and went on maneuvers. There was 344, 45, and 46 that came out of the shipyard together. So out we go. Our whole crew, never seen one, never been on one. So we got out there, and one night it was snowing, and we had the Commodore on. That's like a captain is, and above a captain, but he's right under an admiral. He was on our ship. Because it was all new. Nobody knew what anything was going to happen, how it was going to operate. So we went out there and it got real snowy. And we run into the flag, ripped a hole in that. Because the guys on the bow were supposed to be up to the lookout. They were breathing on the radio equipment. It was all covered with ice. Tell them they get back and let somebody know that we done hit the ship. We put a big hole in the starboard side with anchor flutes. And the skipper on there, it was off of New Jersey, he lost it. He just went really haywire. And here's the Commodore standing right there beside and seeing the whole thing. For news, and we had ACAC 90 millimeter radar controlled guns on in the tank deck. Then we had that thing sitting up on top. Then we went over, got outside of Gibraltar, we had an 800 ship convoy, and the German sub pack got into that. So they broke it up, said, man, you're on your own. So we went back up to Bermuda and met a LST convoy going over, so we joined that. Went back over there then. Went into Algiers and unloaded the LCT off the top. Then went on down to Oran. Then we went in there and started unloading the stuff. Then we went down to Arzu. That was further on down, and they unloaded the guns off. That night we had a hell of an air raid. Bombs falling all around us. Next morning, get up there and shovel the dirt off the top of the deck. Then we went on back then and started training the 1st Infantry Division, the Big Red One, for an invasion of Sicily. We'd pick them up, and beach, and they'd unload, and got the training off of that. We did that back and forth. Then we went to invading of Sicily, we took them into Gela. We were the first ship to beach Gela. And then unloaded them. We went over an 8-foot sandbar. We went over that all right. And we started back out in the 220 over here, LCI, it hit and then mortar shells, it broke their stern anchor cable, and they broached. They lost 11 men out of 21, got scraped and killed them. We pulled them loose and got them off. Then we got stuck on that doggone sandbar getting out. And the Tiger tanks displayed, they shot 200 some odd holes in the starboard side and killed 3 people, injured 2 more. We finally got us over that sandbar. then we had to stand by then until the next wave came in case they had to evacuate the troops, because that's had never been done before. So we loaded and went to Salerno, and we wanted to, Navy wanted to shell Salerno, because he went in there about 150 yards and he went up a mountain. The Germans had that place just zeroed in, crossfire and everything else. The German, that's general, army general said, no, we want to surprise them. Heck, they'd followed us all up the coast. They knew where we was going because that's the only beach in there they could land on. So we started in there and they drove us out. And we had tanks on. Here's our infantry fighting tanks with rifles. We didn't have nothing else in there to fight them with. So we were started in and they drove us out. We went in beach, we had British troops on it. And them troops or something. We went in and hit a sandbar and you couldn't get into the beach with the ramp down, it had 8 feet of water under it. If the troops could have run and jumped about 5 feet or less, they got the feet wet, they wouldn't do that. So we had one of those British officers told his sergeant, I say, let's go. He said, we got 8 feet of water. He said, I said, go. He went right out in 8 feet of water. And the sergeant come up, and the doggone officer sitting down in a seatbelt on, he was drowning. The officer went and got back down, he got him loose and drug him up out. And then we sit there and couldn't get off. And they had a railroad gun up on the mountain up there, 16-incher. He run out of the mountain, shoot, and run back in. And we was getting shot at. They shoot over here, up front. We couldn't, nothing we could do to sit there and sweat it out. And after a while, they got the gun out of the way. And they got tugs in and drug us off. And so we still couldn't land. So that night, they was begging for tanks. And the captain said, boys, we got tanks. They need them. Do you want to go in? He said, we might not come back. He said, if they wouldn't need them, they're dying over there by the... He said, what's 50 more make no difference? So we went in at night and sent the boat in and put two flashlights on the beach. We went in between the beach and landed. And they said, I had a beach master there. You can't, what are you boys doing? You can't come in here. You better turn around and look. By that time, ship slid right up and knocked him down. He got out of the way. He said, that's why we're coming over here, where the ship can land. They lowered the ramp down, and the first three tanks went out and got shut down, blew up right there. And the rest of them got out there, and you could see them. But before they'd unload those tanks, we had to go out there and pull bodies out of the way because they wouldn't run over our own people. A 33-gun tank over human body don't do it any good. We came back down to Camp Bradford, and that was where they formed crews. We formed a crew, went to Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, and that's where the ship was, 781 was made and launched, come down the Ohio River and out to Mississippi. And then we went from there to Honolulu. Then from there we went out island hopping all the way to Saipan, Tinian. We had oil to pay the runway there at Tinian. So off we went to Okinawa and got over there on Easter Sunday, April Fool's Day. That's when we invaded Okinawa. It wasn't no Fool's Day to us. So we went in and beached it, and the airplanes, Japanese, had the control of the air and everything. You just sitting there fighting for your life. We got on the reef, we couldn't get off, so they rolled the barrels of oil out into the water and they rolled them into the beach. And soon we get got that out of there, we get off, we went back out of there on one engine. And we didn't have any Japanese, they were fanatics. They didn't like it. They'd die for the emperor. That was their belief. They'd run up alongside of the ship, swim out and put bombs along the side of it. And on the beach, they'd run up on it. Up on the side of a tank with a fire bomb and set it on fire, and they just wouldn't stop. They machine gun them so bad down, they crawled over top of them to try to get to the Marines on the island. And we didn't have no respect for them at all. There was a dead Japanese, us was a dead Japanese. Because it's him or us. And you wanted to be him. That's the way we felt about the Japanese. The Germans fought a clean war. If they see they were going to get war, they'd surrender and give up. But the Japanese wouldn't. The only way he was going to give up is to be dead.
It's a big, tough, heavily built shipboard fighter, pulling 2,000 horsepower on the takeoff. Greater power and higher wing loading means she'll land faster and stall quicker than the older, slower types of fighters. Normally, the ground crew will start the engine, but every pilot should be familiar with the starting routine. With ignition off, the prop is pulled through 3 or 4 times to clear the cylinders. A cartridge is placed in the breech of the starter, which is reached through a door in the accessory compartment. Cowl flaps open.
Through that period of time, the first thing that we had was, of course, World War II. And most of mine was with the Solomon Islands and up through to Rabaul. And after we had neutralized that area, they brought in a Jeep carrier and put 3 full fighter squadrons on it. And we headed for the Marianas. And that took up almost a month because the town troops hadn't taken the peninsula that the runway was on. And after they finally cleared enough and got the runway back, the island, we went in and worked off that peninsula and strafed and helped clear the rest of the island of Guam. And then after we got that taken care of, then we started up the chain. And they would take the next island up, and if it had a runway on it, they'd clear the runway. And then we were able to strike much deeper because we'd go up and refuel again. We'd be loaded with our ordnance. And then we would go on up and hit. And we worked our way up till we were almost, well, we could have made Japan and come back. We were that close. But our squadron had been out a long time by that time. And we declined the offer. We had been trained before we went out in strafing and dive bombing and rockets and all this sort of thing. So the airplane that I was flying, the Corsair, we were used at low level. And with a fight would be going on above us or on before they even got in the area by the high roving cover. And they would try to keep us from getting any attack on us, because we'd usually be carrying a couple of 1,000-pound bombs and 2 different racks with up to 4 or 5 rockets on. Other times we would have a load and we would leave from a station, a runway somewhere, where they hung maybe 1,000-pounders on us because they wanted to hit something hard. And we'd go out on those strikes and make our attacks. And then I had took a lot of holes in the wings and the fuselage, but when we sit in the cockpit, we've got some controls or some but in my case, there are a bunch of ordnance switches on the dash, and on the right side, they're all protected by a piece of steel that would keep them from coming at me. That would hit that steel and wouldn't knock my switches out. And so when I went out, I went up, they went into the New Hebrides, and then I hooked rides up the chain of command of the New Hebrides and New Caledonia and on up to closer to Japan. And but the main place was the peninsula just above the Bougainville area, was where all the Japanese were. And it was, you know, it was their home almost. There were many, many troops there. And they were staging out of there to go south to make various landings. And they didn't even try to cover their ships with, we had so many planes out there then, and they were attack type. And then we'd also go up and hit the islands themselves, the runways, and bomb them out and strafe all the planes there. And we knew how well we were doing by the number of holes we took. If we got a lot of holes, we knew we had a lot more to do. But when you come back and didn't even have a hole, we knew we were through with that one and move on up.
America goes to war. Men of the Army, Navy, and Marines reinforce the battlefronts on six continents to save the homes and ideals of free men from Axis domination. In Ireland, United States fighting men, who have safely crossed the submarine-infested Atlantic, strengthen their ever-increasing ranks. Yanks on the march on Irish South.
Joined when I was 17, and they took me on my 18th birthday. And from there, I went into boot camp for 5 weeks, and after 5 weeks, I caught the ship, the Daniel T. Griffin, in New York. And I just decided to go over it. I didn't want to be drafted because I wanted a nice, clean bed to sleep in. I didn't want to sleep in a foxhole. That's why I joined the Navy. The convoy, when we used to take the convoys over the North Atlantic, we used to go over to Ireland, and the English would come out with their ship, take the convoy, and we'd go up to Londonderry Island, and would stay there for a week before the convoy was ready to come back to the U.S. again. And that's what we did. I made three or four trips that way. Naturally, the convoy, we were protect the convoy from German submarines. And then there was one incident there that the German submarine developed some type of a torpedo that could pick up the vibration of your screws on the ship, and the torpedo would follow those vibrations, and that's how they were able to blow up the ships. So we devised nothing spectacular. It was just an iron rod with about 200 or 300 feet of cable on it. And that, when we threw that, when we got a German attack, we'd throw that rod out, and that rod would vibrate in the water stronger than the screws, so the torpedo would hit that vibration of the rod. And there were times in the North Atlantic, you wouldn't believe the waves. There were times when the waves were so strong, it would pick up a ship, one of the convoy ships, it'd pick it right out of the war, the wave would be so high, 30, 40 feet, the ship would be on top of that wave, and then the wave would drop, and the ship was in completely in the air. And you could see the screws turning and everything, and before it fell down, back into the water again. It was amazing what those waves would do to a ship. Then they converted us. In other words, they put walls on the main deck to house the SEALs, frogmen at the time. So they'd have a place to sleep. But instead of giving us the frogmen, they gave us the ammunition for the frogmen, which was 96 tons of high explosive. And that's what we went through the whole Pacific Fleet area, and we went to the we were at the invasion of Okinawa, and at the time, on my 19th birthday, April 6th, we shot down three Jap planes. We liberated the Philippine Islands. We were there. All the other islands, Iwo Jima and all those other islands, we were in on the invasion of those. And we did quite a tour of the, and at one time at Okinawa, we followed a Jap submarine all the way into the harbor of Japan. But we never got them. But we had a captain that was gung-ho. And he said, we're going to follow that son of a gun until we get him. But we never did get him, but we got into the harbor. And that was before the Japs surrendered. Well, it's funny how it happened. We were taking a convoy out from New York. That's where we used to come back into New York when we brought the convoys back. This particular, in 1944, and we were taking a convoy over to Europe, and that's when they told me I was going to be a mess cook, and I says, all right, no problem. And a mess cook had to stay clean because he was serving food all the time, and I decided to take a shower with this other buddy of mine, and we went had it, and all of a sudden, while we were in the shower, all soaped up, the general quarter bell rings, and you had to get to your station. Well, I had to go to the station. I was nude. I had to go there, and I sat on my gun station, which was on the aft end of the ship, and eventually somebody did throw me a jacket after I was sitting there for maybe 10, 20 minutes, not thinking of I was nude. All I was in, told that I had to get to my station. But we laughed about it afterwards, but not while we were there. Well, there was times when we, in the Philippines, we, like I say, we liberated that country, and all the other, we went to a couple of dozen different islands out there, and there was times when we would relax on one of the islands and play baseball. As a matter of fact, I think one of the, I forget his name, but one of the DiMaggio boys was on the island, and we played baseball. He came in and we played baseball with him. And other than that, the people on the islands, when we were anchored, they'd come out with their canoes, and they'd have the whole family with them on the canoe, chickens and everything. And I had pictures of little kids on the canoe smoking cigarettes. What they wanted was cigarettes and your bed cover. And they'd make a moo-moo out of it. They'd cut a couple of holes out of the hole for their head, and they'd use it for a dress. And they were giving us $20 for each moo-moo. And that was a lot of money at the time. And the, like I say, the kids would be sitting in the canoe smoking cigarettes, and the chickens would be squawking and everything while they were. But we had some funny times, but naturally those didn't last too long. But then they decided, that's when they got us all assembled for the invasion of Okinawa. We were there from the first day, April 1st. Nothing happened. The Army and the Marines landed on the island. Nothing happened until all of a sudden on the 6th of April was when they started sending their Japanese suicide planes out. And they sent over 3,000 suicide planes at us. They knocked out a lot of battleships and bigger ships, but there was another destroyer out there with us on what they call a screening duty. Three airplanes came out at us, and they dropped 500-pound bombs at us, but they missed. And like I say, we shot down three of them. And then the next day, they come out with more of them, and they hit the destroyer that was with us. The plane went in one side of the bow, the side of the bow to the other, where I was on my ship. So I would have been dead. But it set it on fire. They killed about 20 guys at the time. And we went over and to help her put out her fire. We went alongside the ship and we helped put out her fire, and we took her dead and put it on the fantail of the ship. And other than that's about the most rescue we did at the time. But like I say, anytime we had to refuel at sea, so the tankers would come out to the ship and they'd throw a line over to refuel the ship. And when they did, being in the area of the suicide planes, well, as soon as we got another contact, well, naturally, that hose went off that ship like you wouldn't know. Because we want to get the hell away from that tanker, because we didn't want to be any closer in case she got hit. And we just circle around until we got an all clear, and then we'd go back to get refueled again. But like I say, if we had gotten hit, we had 96 tons of high explosive aboard. So you can see, I'd be just a memory. And after that, we went to general quarters about 150 times. You had to sleep with your clothes on, because you were going to general quarters every hour on the hour. You had no time even to go to the bathroom half the time. That's how often you went to general quarters. But being 19 years old, what the hell do you know, right? You're only a kid, and you took it in stride. They say, it's not going to happen to me, is it? And that's the way we went through the war. And then after the war was declared ended, it took us almost a year to go back to New York. And we decommissioned the ship there. We flew a flag that you had a flag. Everybody got a piece of it. It was only a ribbon about 3 or 5 inches wide, and it was about 100 feet long. And everybody got a piece of it because you were out of the country for over a year. And we flew this ribbon, and everybody got a piece after we pulled into the harbor. But when we were in the North Atlantic, we went through the canal to go to the Pacific. And then when we came back out of the Pacific, we went back to the canal again, came back over to the East Coast, and that's where they decommissioned the ship. And evidently, they must have just broke it apart and for parts and everything. And that, then I went to, I had enough points to get out of the service, and they sent me back to, I was discharged in South Boston at the Fargo building, and I lived in South Boston at the time, so I didn't get a nickel for transportation, so I just grabbed my duffel bag and walked home. I had to walk probably about 2 miles, that was it. And got home and nothing was said. You didn't talk about it. I had a brother that was in the Army, and just went on with life after that. That was it.
Second birthday of the Waves, America's Women of the Navy. In Cedar Falls, Iowa, they celebrate by setting out for nearby farms to help relieve farm labor shortages.
My name is Tommy Haskins, and I served in the Navy Waves Hospital Corps. We took all of our training, both basic and hospital training, at Hunter College, the Bronx, New York. It was pretty intense training, both ways. We became quite close, my platoon, in 16 weeks. Got to know one another pretty well. And then when the time came for us to get our duty assignments, it was a little sad there for a while because that meant that we would be parting company. But it was a wonderful education for all of us. It really was. And especially, it was very rigorous basic training, and then even more rigorous hospital training. But when we finally got our assignments, we felt prepared, and it so happened that my roommate and I got sent to the same assignment, the first assignment. My first assignment was to the Marine Base, Camp Lejeune, North Carolina. We worked in the big naval hospital there and the dispensary, trying to take care of all these wounded men, soldiers, who were being shipped back from overseas, so many of them wounded. But we had been trained quite well, and so we certainly strive to do our jobs well. I had my moments, some of the wounded veterans, and we had basket cases. We had a few of those. And I had to learn not to let my feelings show. And by the way, 66 years later, I'm still working within hospital walls. Visiting sick patients. I'm an assistant to the chaplain of Parish Medical Center now, and I love my work there. I really do. If all I do is give each patient hope that it isn't going to always be this way, that they will get through it. And this is how I used to comfort all these wounded coming back, to sit and talk with them. And of course, some of them had PTS, I think that's what it's called. They were so stressed out, they wouldn't talk about anything. They just looked at the walls. But this was also a challenge to me, and it still is. When I have cases like that now, it's a challenge to me to get them to talking. And I usually have pretty fair success. Now, apparently, the base psychiatrist for Camp Lejeune found himself without a secretary. And so the powers that be looked through the files, and they saw in my file that I had had quite a bit of business training already. I could take shorthand at 120 words a minute, and I was a fast typist. So guess who got chosen to work with a psychiatrist who was kind of scary sometimes. But I learned a lot from him. I really did, even though there were times when I thought he was a little bit nutty, but anyway, it was quite an experience. However, I must admit that I was kind of happy when I got my next assignment, which was to the Naval Hospital, the big Naval Hospital at Norfolk, Virginia. And there, they placed me with the captain of the whole 5th Naval District as a secretary. And back then, we didn't have computers. We had something called ediphones. He would dictate on a little disc, and I would put the little disc on my ediphone. I operated it with pedals, and that's how I transcribed my notes. A lot of people won't know what in the world an ediphone is, but that's how we did it back then. So back to the family. They were very much against their youngest child, their youngest daughter, getting into any branch of the service. They didn't want me to have any part of it. They didn't think I was old enough. And there were too many dangers, too many unknowns to them. And this is what they were worried about, all those unknowns. But every day, as I listened to these pleas coming over the radio, we didn't have TV back then, pleas for young women to come in and get trained to help take care of so many wounded soldiers that were being shipped back from overseas. This was in early 1945. And I couldn't resist it. I just couldn't resist it. And so I went against my family's wishes, and I went down to their recruiters. Of course, it took them quite a while to do a background check on me and get all my grades from school. I had to pass a pretty stiff test there, but finally I'm in. And I'm on a train headed for New York. And then the time came when I had to make a choice. I could either stay in and make the Navy a career, I had that privilege, or I could exit. And I deliberated quite a while over that, and then I elected to exit, because I wanted to finish my education, and that's what I ended up doing. I've had a few regrets, but mostly I'm glad that I did exit, because I immediately registered to go back to Florida State University in Tallahassee and complete my education. My major was business administration.
Tinny, this is for you. And Billy, this is for you. It's Mother's Christmas present.
War bonds?
Yes, darling, war bonds.
Well, gee, thanks a lot, Mom, but
I wanted a bicycle. I know you did, Tinny. And I know that Billy wanted a railroad. But I feel that you're both old enough to realize that your country's at war and to be willing to make sacrifices for it. Just think, if Daddy were wounded, one single war stamp might pay for the medicine that would save him from pain, even save his life. Any bond that you or I give as a present is much more than a gift. It's a Christmas blessing to those men who will be far away on this Christmas day.
My name is Edward C. King. I joined the Navy in 1943 at the age of 19. The reason I joined was that was the thing to do in those days. Anybody that was physically qualified volunteered. A lot had to be drafted also. I went to an induction center with 52 people. Only 50 passed the physical. Most of them came back and went to work for the shipyard making big money, where I made $21 a month. And was proud to get it though. They transferred me from Bainbridge to Corpus Christi, Texas, Naval Air Station. The most casualties from aircraft I ever seen was at Corpus Christi. Some of the corpses I helped retrieve, they didn't look like humans, they looked like hamburger. But it shook me up, so I thought about it long and long ago. From Corpus Christi, they sent me to New Orleans Naval Hospital. There I had a great experience of inducting crews that had been sunk by the Japanese. No records, no nothing, but the breath they had between their lungs. We had to make them out all new, what he called jackets of induction. I was sent to Brooklyn Navy Yard and assigned to the hospital ship USS Benevolence, AH-13. That ship was commissioned in May of 1945, made various inspection and shakedown cruises in the Potomac, got degouged in Bayonne, New Jersey. That's to prevent a ship from attracting landmine. We was all preparing to invade the island of Japan. That invasion was composed of around 900 plus ships. It would have made the Normandy invasion look like a sideshow. On September the 2nd, 1945, my ship, the USS Benevolent, was anchored approximately 500 yards off the bow of the Missouri. As the ceremony was progressing, I've watched it through a pair of binoculars. MacArthur, the master of ceremony, was in charge. Admiral Nimitz signed for the U.S. and General Wainwright stood in the back observing. We evacuated all the prisoners in that camp, deloused them, fed them, clothed them, checked them for all physical defects, put them on fast destroyers for the Philippines. Immediately following the ceremony, the sky was blacked out with so many B-29s you couldn't count them. In fact, it looked like darkness was coming about without notice. It was a glorious sight that I don't know, only a very learned man could describe. My specific job was what is known as an ENT specialist. That's ear, nose, and throat. We've done several eye enucleations. That's removal of the eye from various kinds of casualties. Some were even under Japanese. That we had one strike a barge full of black powder and it exploded, knocked one of his eyes out and partially the other one. The ship had a band. They played very good dance music. We had 30 nurses, 2 Red Cross women, and 500 sailors. So that's not a very good ratio. And the captain, he was the man that captured anyone he wanted. He was an old salt, 42 years in the Navy. He had been recalled to take command of the Benevolence.
Young America, proud, vigorous, undaunted, is hard at work and at play, going forward in every field of endeavor in the face of changing world conditions which, a short decade ago, the youth of that generation faced. Uncle Sam must be pretty fond of these nephews of his, that vast army of youngsters who, by their respect for the past of America and their love for the present of America, are ensuring the future of America.
I'm Bill Logan. I was born and raised in Alabama, joined the Navy in August the 4th of 1944, and I was born on March the 21st of 29, so I was 15 years old when I joined. And when I went in to join, my mother went with me, because she had to sign that I was old enough. But I had an ace on my side, an ace in the hole, where she was Miss Great Britain of 1926 or somewhere in there, 27. And so when I went in, I did not have enough weight to meet the minimum standard. And the old chief couldn't take his eyes off my mother. And so he said, well, take him out. I was only about a pound or so under. So take him out and feed him a whole bunch of bananas and water and come back and let's try it and let's do it again. So we did. And I came back in and I still lacked just a very little bit of meeting the, well, I think it was 116 pounds. That's not much. But anyway, I wasn't quite there, but he let me in anyway. He said he went ahead and signed me up. At that time, I was a skinny, scrawny kid. I looked like I had just come out of grade school, which basically I had, you know, but very, very young And so anyway, as I went into service, I went to Great Lakes. Didn't like Great Lakes at all, didn't like that. And I was the youngest, scrawniest kid in the company. And naturally, I caught hell every time it turned around. I was getting hell from somebody. And all the S details, to trying to be on it, be nice, all the S details that came up Navy-wise, I was all volunteered for them automatically. But when I got ready to leave after all this time in Great Lakes, I actually was sad. I don't know why, but I was sad that I was leaving. I didn't like it, but after I got to that point to leave, it was pretty good. Anyway, trying to make a long story short, I was went through the normal thing with the various stations, naval stations that where they send you out. And I was assigned first to a destroyer, Fletcher class 2100, John Rogers 570 destroyer 574, squadron 25. And after they were in Mare Island, had coming back from all the battles that they'd had in the Philippines, and did a lot of damage. So I met them in Mare Island, and I went aboard. And I'll never forget, and I still have the picture in my mind today. That's almost 70 years later, in fact, more than 70 years later, of me coming aboard that ship. And here I was, looking like a little skinny grade school kid, and struggling with my sea bag to get up the ramp in, onto the ship. And here was about, must have been six or eight old salts, as I call them, regular navies, all standing around the gangway. And they were talking, and I could see them as I'm coming up the gangplank with the gestures they were making and the way they were looking, that they were probably saying to themselves, "They're robbing the cradle." I'm sure they did. But anyway, it was embarrassing as heck. Here are all these guys, our old salts, and here I am coming in looking like a grade school kid and weighing no more than I did. And I'm struggling like heck to get up the gangplank with my sea bag. Anyway, after shakedown cruises and loading supplies and ammunition, we headed west. When we stopped in Pearl Harbor, which I was really impressed with, because in those days, Pearl Harbor, and that had nothing to do with the attack, but this is after the attack quite a ways, but Pearl Harbor had the most wonderful smell in the air of flowers. And I had talked to somebody, and they said that was natural in Hawaii. And but anyway, we went on to the west and joined up with Bull Halsey's task force 58.1. Now this destroyer that I was on, that was one of about 20 other destroyers. And if you look it down on the group as a clock, all the battleships were around, all the carriers and the cruisers as well, and then all the destroyers were out. They were called picket boats. And so the destroyers were out far enough. Some of them were even out 50 miles from the center of the fleet. And so they would be the first to make contact with radar and alert the fleet that the Japanese were coming in, with the descriptions of where, when, and which direction and all this kind of stuff. So we were with Halsey's group for quite a while. Of course, we had many attacks of kamikazes, and some of them got in, some most of them didn't, but those that did get in, they caused a lot of trouble. Then in June of 1945, we had the biggest typhoon that they've ever had out there, and Halsey made the bad decision to turn the wrong way, and we ended up right into the darn thing. And brief description, they put out a bulletin. They didn't put it on their air, but they sent bulletins around to the ship's captains. And general information, the storm did more damage to the U.S. fleet than the Japanese had done in the entire war, this one storm. And to give you an example of how bad it was, the Bennington and the Lexington, which are huge carriers, and their bow is like this, and their flight deck comes out over the bow, you know, quite a ways. And the waves were so high, and mind you, this is a carrier, huge. The waves were so high that the flight deck of the carriers were bent down and molded around the bow. And that storm was so bad that the Pittsburgh, which is a heavy cruiser, lost its bow. The waves were hitting it so bad, so high, and so often that the bow broke off of the ship right aft of the forward gun, and they lost a lot of lives there in that. They never did recover. Those that were on that bow section were never recovered. As far as the Japanese getting in, we knocked down quite a few of them, but the history shows that there was a lot of them that did get in. They were torpedo bombers, and the one that did the most damage was the one that hit the Franklin, the carrier Franklin, and it exploded. The bomb went down in through the deck into the area where they repaired the planes, and of course the ship was totally destroyed, out of propulsion and everything. They ended up having to tow it back to the United States. There was a lot of action, and I have a diary. And there was one section of the diary where some sucker, I won't use the word that I really use for him, but some sucker that hid my diary for a while. And of all the time, was the time when we were having the most incoming Japanese attacks. But I made up for it as best I could. But anyway, in February of 1945, we made the landings at Iwo Jima. And again, I was 15. We did not do anything going ashore, but what we did was, as the huge fleet of supplies and troops and everything are gathering, the destroyer group was running up and down the beach and shelling, trying to knock out all the pillboxes and the best that we could. As it turns out, I didn't know this until about 3 years ago, and here we are right now in 2013, and I did not know, but all the shelling that we did was practically worthless, because unless we hit one of the pillboxes direct, because the Japanese had tunnels underneath down in there that was even more sophisticated than the Vietnamese had in Vietnam. And whenever they discovered all those, they couldn't believe that how elaborate they were. But the Japanese, when we started shelling, they probably just went down into those tunnels and didn't bother them any. So anyway, that's what we did. We run up and down and shelled and supported the landing. And as the troops began to actually come in the Higgins boats, we stopped because of the damage, the opportunity of, or maybe the problem of maybe hitting some of our people. But the same thing happened. We went on later on. It was about, I had just turned 16, and I think so that meant that it would have to have been about March or April, I believe, that we did the same thing at Okinawa. But it was basically the same thing we did. We didn't have any problems, except Okinawa was a hornet's nest. There was more kamikazes at Okinawa than we had ever come across anywhere. They were everywhere. The air was full of them. And we lost a couple of the destroyers, two kamikazes. And we had one incident in particular that sticks out like a sore thumb in my mind. It was late in the evening. It had already just turned dark, and we had general quarters. And so we had a incoming aircraft. And as it turns out, the aircraft, fleet with all these carriers, the main thing that they were doing is they're sending planes over Japan, and mostly Tokyo and those areas, and bombing. And so the planes were returning from their bombings to the fleet, and it was dark. And and the American planes have what they call IFF, meaning a means of identifying that they are American planes, which if they came in without that, they would shoot them down anyway. So here we are, we've got a group of planes that's returning from Japan, and it's dark, and here's a plane that's coming in behind them. He did not have IFF. But they couldn't take any chances where maybe his was out or if it was Japanese. And it's, as it turned out, it was Japanese. So one of the planes went back and they encountered him. And then a few minutes later, they told him to pull away, leave him, because we were going to start firing. And so he had to get out of there. So one of the planes the plane that came in decided that he was going to come down and get us. And he was smart because he came directly from the stern and was coming right at us. Whereby if he'd come from the side, we could have got more guns after him. But from the back, we had very limited. And as I said, he was smart. So anyway, he came in. And with all the firing and everything after him, they did not hit him until he was about 150 yards from our stern. And when he exploded, his engines and all his parts and everything hit our decks. I think one of the guys got some shrapnel, but in general, nobody was really hurt. But we had parts all over the stern of our ship and all along the decks and everything. If he had a hit, the way he was coming, he would hit right where I was, and because we have in the back, they have gun four is higher, and gun five is below. And so he would have hit in that area, and that's where we were. Thank God that the 40 millimeters got him. Anyway, after the war was over, we were in the harbor, and we were getting ready to send troops ashore. And I decided that the war was over, I want to go home. So I went up to the executive officer, walked in, I said, can I talk with you for a minute? Sure. What do you need? Well, the war is over, I want to go home. He looked at me and laughed like hell. He says, so do we, all of us. We want to all go home. Laughing like crazy. He said, what makes you so special? I said, I'm only 16 years old. He said, well, you have your mother go to the state office and have them send me your birth certificate, not your mother. Have them send me your birth certificate. They did. And so anyway, we were back to sea at that time, and we were moving, refueling from the Massachusetts, which is a battleship. And I'm a little skinny guy, and I'm dirty, you know. I got on my dungarees and not clean. And the chief came to me, and he gave me 5 minutes. He said, you got 5 minutes to get down there and get your gear and get back up here. Well, hell, it took me 10 minutes to get just to get my gear, you know, at least, and run like hell. And I didn't get everything, but I had most of my stuff. He said, you're going home. Oh, so they put me on the bosun chair, which is, I forget the correct name of it, but anyway, it's a bosun chair, and it runs a line between the two ships as we're refueling, and the water is, you know. So they put me on the Massachusetts, battleship Massachusetts. And I sure am glad that I didn't get service aboard a battleship, because it was a seagoing battle base station, and probably the most HS operation that you have ever seen. Everything had to be spit and polished, and here I am, a little scrawny, skinny, dirty kid coming off of a tin can, and they were all looking at me like, where did you come from, you know? But anyway, I got cleaned up, and I rode the Massachusetts back to Bremerton, Washington. Got discharged, and went back downtown to where I had heard my dad was, and he was managing a Coast Guard type station, not Coast Guard, but the Marine group, but not Coast Guard, but it was Maritime Club. And so, as it turned out, he was ready to go back east, and I said, well, okay, we'll go back east. So we did. I went for a while back to high school. I was so bored from having been in the service and everything, I just couldn't take it. I couldn't stand it. So next thing you know, I re-enlisted. After I was 17, I re-enlisted. This time I went into submarine service.
This summer, plan your vacation at home. Clear the track for victory by helping save vital rail space. Space needed for the movement of troops and the comfort of wounded men. WEIF, New York. The program usually scheduled over many of these stations, The Art of Living, will not be heard at this time in order that the National Broadcasting Company may bring you Bob Hope in a special program from a naval hospital in the South Pacific. The Art of Living will be heard at its regular time next week. We now take you to the South Pacific.
From somewhere in the South Pacific, we present the Bob Hope Show.
Okay, my name is George Van Staden. I live in Titusville, Florida. I served in the Marine Corps Reserve right after Pearl Harbor for about 3.5 years. See, after Pearl Harbor, as you know, there was a great patriotism that unfortunately isn't here today. So I enlisted in December, effective in January, so I could go in after New Year's Eve. And then I reported to Parris Island in January 42. And I served beginning in Guadalcanal that August, and then Cape Gloucester, which secured the Rabaul area, and then Peleliu. Those were my three major campaigns, all in the Regimental Weapons Company, 5th Marines, 1st Marine Division. Well, Guadalcanal was the first land offensive after Pearl Harbor, along with Midway for the Navy. It's said to be one of the two turning points in the war in the Pacific. After Guadalcanal, the Japanese had no more successful land offensive after that. It was a turning point. It was a very early date. You know, when Pearl Harbor came out, the Marines weren't all that well organized. All they had was a brigade or two, and they formed the 1st Marine Division. And we were, most of us, fresh out of boot camp. They had what they call the old breed. This was those guys who were in already as career people when Pearl Harbor occurred. So they were spotted in squad leaders and platoon leaders selectively, but most of us were raw boots. Now, unfortunately, whereas normally you have 5 months in Parris Island in those days in boot camp, they condensed it into 5 weeks. Okay, so we were 5 weeks at Parris Island, and then we went to New River, which is now called the June. Now, at New River, we're going to complete our training, get the field training, the maneuvers, and all that. And then a decision was made that there wasn't that much time, that the Japs were a threat in the South Pacific to Australia and New Zealand and the shipping lanes. So the decision was made to ship us to New Zealand, a place called Paikakariki, New Zealand. It's a suburb of Wellington. So we went there, and we're going to complete our training, get the 5 months there. Well, the word came that they were building the Japs were building an airfield on Guadalcanal in this remote Solomon's Island area, which would be a threat to everybody. So then the decision was made, we couldn't get the 5 months training. We had 5 weeks, roughly, in Paikakariki, which was enough to get settled, turn around, and help load our ships for combat. I say help load because at that time, although what they called the wharfies, the New Zealand people that worked at the wharf and loaded ships, they went on a strike right in the middle of this period. So we Marines had to go down and do their job. So we actually combat loaded our ships that went on to Guadalcanal ourselves at the dock and shipped out early. Again, we had no training. So they were going to have a make-believe landing, at the Fiji Islands on the way to Guadalcanal. It was strategically located, but they made one mistake. They picked the wrong side of an island, and then we were going to go on a sandy beach and go through what Marines are trained to do. What happened were a bunch of black volcanic rocks, and the Higgins boats couldn't crash in. We had to float in, get off, and wade in and all that. So they picked the wrong beach. So again, that was a disaster. We didn't get any training on a make-believe landing either. So anyway, then we went on to Guadalcanal. So August 7th, 1942, was the day we landed at Guadalcanal. Again, we learned to fight and got our experience under fire, and it was a unique situation. And unfortunately there, one of the first battles of the area between Guadalcanal and the other islands in the Iron Bottom Sound, they call it, because so many ships got sunk there. The Navy lost several key cruisers, the heart of their attack fleet, other than the carrier, and couldn't stay there for the 3 days it normally takes to support a landing. So what happened, we hit the beach on August 7th, and something like the 8th, 9th, they moved out. They left us with just about a 30-day supply of ammunition and food. We were just abandoned, and General Vandergus was very upset, but the decision was made to, they had to, after Pearl Harbor with a decimated fleet, they couldn't risk the carrier support of our landing. They had to pull out. So we were landed with skeleton gear, skeleton food, skeleton clothing, the whole ball of wax. So at that point at Guadalcanal, it was a very difficult thing. At any given time, since we had no Navy to defend us, no Air Force to support us, the thought was the Japs, they're good, they're going to counterattack. So General Vandergrift, what decimated division he had about a 5-mile perimeter. He had Lunga, the Lunga River Point, which was on the ocean, and then south of that, the Iolo and Tenru Rivers, and east of that and west of that was the Matanica River and the point. And on the back of us, this was in the tropics, you know, on the equator. And back of all this was the jungle and the mountains. So our perimeter was to protect both flanks and the beach, and we were spread out that way. The first day was sort of not too active. We did take Kukum Village, and we secured the beginning airstrip. And then when it was clear that the Navy had run out on us, then we had to go into a defensive mode. We couldn't search out the Japs. We had to, in effect, prepare for survival. So I was in the perimeter. My guns were part of a beach defense out of our weapons company. We had 37-millimeter anti-tank guns and one French 75, and this was commanding below Lunga Point, the area where the Japs most likely would counterattack if they were going to hit the beach. And then the other troops were deployed on both flanks, and we were prepared to dig in. Actually, the situation was so difficult. That's a good word. Vandergrift actually had his key officers develop a guerrilla warfare defense plan, that if indeed they hit us from both flanks and the front, and we didn't even have a full division on the beach, that we would fall back to the mountains and the jungle and fight guerrilla warfare and defense. Actually, I knew a Major Gately who used to come to my company reunions. He was in charge of burning the records that were necessary, so we left no trace. It was that bad. So anyway, we made up. Fortunately, there was a lot of rice and canned fish and stuff. And I should say, in Kuka Village, there were some sake and some Philippine beer, which was pretty good. That's one of the things that was nice to take over. So anyway, we deployed and we're settled in for a defensive maneuver. So that's how all that got started, and the mode we're in, with a bunch of guys that hadn't been taught to fight yet. There was one interesting thing. People don't know it probably. You've heard of McElhinney's Tabasco sauce? Major McElhinney was one of the throne then, and he served in our regiment as a dollar-a-year man. Major McElhinney, he had money. He had two pearl-handled pistols, one on each hip. And he was, you know, quite a guy. And at Pavuvu, a lot of these rat nests were up in the top. And one day, he shot. I remember some Marines said, did you get him, Major? He said, I shot, didn't I? With that, of course I shot. Anyway, Major McElhinney, one of the things about him, wherever we served, every mess hall had free McElhinney's Tabasco sauce on a table. And if the food wasn't so hot, you'd shake in a little Tabasco sauce to make it better. So to us, Major McElhinney was sort of a hero in his own right, as far as the company was concerned. We were there, I think, the second week. We were on beach defense, and it started raining a lot. You know, you stand watches, and I was on 4 to 4 to 4 watch. I was at 4 o'clock in the morning. I'm sitting on one of the trails. The 37 millimeter anti-tank gun has 2 trails. They dig in the sand and all that. And I was sitting on one all by myself. 4 o'clock in the morning. It's raining. I got a poncho over my head. And there had been some word that the Japs were infiltrating the lines from the west. And all of a sudden, I saw there's 2 guys. I gave them a halt, and they started to run. I took out my 45, and I shot at them. I got on the CP, and they said, 2 Japs coming through, 2 Japs coming through, and so forth. Pretty soon, trigger-happy Marines were shooting up all over the place. So anyway, came dawn, and what do you think we found? On the bank of the Lunga River, was this cow. What I saw was the head and the rump. That was my 2 chaps. And that he was dead on the banks of the river. So I thought, oh, my God, what's going to happen to me? So anyway, I thought, we'll wait and see. Well, first thing they did, they sent down a company from mess hall that knew how to butcher, and we had fresh meat for the first time since we hit the island. So I'm a hero. I'm not going to get there. I got a beat on me for the 2 Japs. I was an instant hero. Later on Guadalcanal is a sidebar. When the Army first came in, they came in late November to relieve it. And I think it was the 182nd Infantry. I'm not sure. The father of Sue Patrizio next door was in that outfit. We talked one time. But anyway, they came in and they loaded their stuff on the beach. You know, they had big, Army's great. They had all this storage, you know. And that night it got shrunk and shrunk and shrunk, because for the first time, our raggedy-ass Marines found they could get clean khaki. We ravished that dump the first night, I'm telling you. I remember I had a 10-pound ham somehow. A box of Blackstone cigars. we took full advantage of the Army dump when it first came ashore, and then, but it was during that period, I think, that we had the worst night in Guadalcanal history. The beginning of bombing in the day, all night long, the Japanese fleet lobbed their bombs at us, and for, I'd say, 24 hours straight, we had non-stop onslaught, either by air or by sea or whatnot. They knocked out all of our torpedo bombers off of Henderson, damaged almost every airplane, and that was a night that if you didn't know how to pray, you learned how to pray that night. It was really devastating.
Your commentator is Len Sterling. Lieutenant General Buckner and Vice Admiral Turner observed the Fifth Fleet's terrific bombardment of Okinawa. One intrepid rocket launching ship moves in close to pulverize shore defenses. The United States 10th Army and the 3rd Marine Amphibious Corps start for the beach. Expecting another Iwo Jima, the surprise Yanks.
My name is Frederick Christian Doctor. I served in the U.S. Navy in the Second World War. My first and most vivid reaction was December 7th, 1941, when we were attacked by Japan at Pearl Harbor. As a young man, this frightened me considerably to think, gee, we're our country's being bombed. And I think most Americans, that young men at my time, were pretty much in the same type of mental attitude. Gosh, they attacked us. And it was our duty as a citizen of the United States to come to our country's aid and to serve wherever we could. So, I graduated in 1944, 1944, the very first part in January, and I was sent to Columbia University Midshipman School, where I was there till May, I believe, and then I was assigned in Coronado, San Diego, clean across the country from one end to the other. Now, when I got there, it was a totally different situation. I was put in with a whole group of other officers. Some of them were rather famous at the time. Dennis Day, who was a singer for Jack Benny, and Harry, what's his name? Harry Babbitt, who was with Kay Kaiser's orchestra. He and Jenny Sims were the singers. And I was enjoying myself pretty much. We practiced hitting the beach with our LCVPs and LCMs in Coronado. We picked up our first ship, the USS Kenton, in Long Beach, California, and took it out on its maiden voyage. And we were in that ship until the war's end. I was in the officers of the day, deck. I had a gunnery station in battle, and I had the first lieutenant was the general care of the ship. I was the maintenance to stand watch to duties, and we proceeded to load up our first group of troops. We hauled about 2,500 troops and their equipment. We had 12 LCVPs and 2 LCMs. The ship had a crew of about 500, and we carried about 2,500 troops. After an invasion, we became a hospital ship. So we also had about 8 to 10 doctors aboard the ship, and some hospital facilities. Well, our first group was we picked up our first load Army or Marines, I forget which it was, in Long Beach, and we went, sailed west to Yap, Ulithi, where we were preparing to invade the Philippine Islands. And the Leyte, the island of Leyte, was where we were scheduled to land. So we were on this, in this area for a few weeks, where we were organizing the fleet ready to attack. This involved thousands of ships, as it was a major invasion. And we had, I forget any more of the time, we also did the same thing for Okinawa. With this, I remember more clearly in my mind, because it was, we were scheduled to hit the beach on Easter Sunday morning in 1945, and that was the day that's etched in my memory. Easter Sunday is the day we hit Okinawa. This was, I don't know, somebody said somewhere, 10,000 ships involved. It could have been, because to see the sky with the kamikaze planes shooting every plane that was even visible, you would see tracer bullets by the zillions aimed in at this plane, blowing it up. Usually, the closest plane to me was maybe 500, 700, 800 feet. It was close enough for me to see the blood on the pilot's face as that plane missed us and hit the water. And it was an amazing thing. When that plane hit the water, we expected an explosion, but that plane cut through the water, and there was hardly a ripple where that plane at that speed, as it was diving down, it was fantastic. Even some of the sailors who were on our LCVP boats getting ready to take troops ashore were run over to circle quick to see whether there was any souvenirs when the plane landed. It was a little funny, but I mean, it was, you just have a feeling when you're that age, nothing can happen to you. You lead a special life that no matter how close close to some, it came to being your time was up. It was just one of those things. It was, you took it, and well, that was a close call. And you go on to the next one. And this was just such a great time. I want to tell you one thing. We went to, 3 or 4 days after we landed, our troops had moved well inland, and we were allowed, as a couple of us officers, allowed to go ashore and on our off duty and just walk around, see what some of the things that happened. We had a Jeep at our disposal, so we drove and we'd stop at a few homes and see what was left of them and look around. And by the way, we were told that the Japanese were Shintoists. That means they were emperor worshipers, and they were very rabid in their support for the emperor. They would gladly die for him, anything. So we looked in this, we stopped by this one house, and I just walked over the window, and I looked in the house, and here on the wall was a picture of Christ in Gethsemane as a common Christian picture, kneeling and praying. And I thought, wow, this is Japan. This is Shintoism. And this is here? I put a little different in perspective on the whole thing, because I know that a lot of other people are just like us. Shortly after this, everybody was given their final weeks. We hadn't had a week for two years, so we all, whoever could get it, we'd got to leave. So I got to leave and was at home for 2 weeks, and then went back in the service. I got assigned to the oldest ship in the U.S. Navy, the USS Artie. It's a refrigerator ship, and we sailed it back across the Pacific. Our engines were literally shot. We could make about five knots, and that's a long river or long ocean to cross at 5 knots. So we had some old canvas and stuff aboard. We made the sailors made the sails out of these, that we strung the sails between our booms, and we were able to make almost 7 knots with that, if the wind was favorable.
Women in the war. U.S. Navy nurses line up for inspection in their new summer uniforms. Every day, new legions are being called to active duty afloat and ashore. Ready to follow the fleet to any battlefront, these traditional angels of mercy know but one code: service to humanity. Women, as always, the heroes of all wars.
My name is Evelyn Van Staden. When I was in nursing school, I had no intention of going into service. But after Pearl Harbor, I thought it might be a good idea. I did have an offer from someplace in New England to go to London, but it wasn't the Navy, and my assistant supervisor at the hospital wanted me to join the Army, which he did, but I sort of hung out and finally joined the Navy, went into Brooklyn, and then to Portsmouth, and Naval Medical Center in Bethesda, Maryland. We had a wonderful scientist at National Institutes of Health who was working on a tropical disease, schistosomiasis, and he became infected with that and died at the Naval Medical Center. I've always remembered that. And then there was a fire at the Marine Girls Barracks in Carolina, someplace. And I specialed a girl who was burned in that fire, and she showed me a picture of what she looked like before, and she will never look like that again. It was a horrible experience, and I've always remembered it. So I specialed her a few times at the hospital, and when the boys started to come back, This was a Marine ward, and there were about 46 of them. Some of them were there, you know, in the service, you have to be completely well before you go back to duty. So some of them would get up and go out and, you know, take off for a while. But a lot of them were sick enough, they stayed on the ward. And they had a lot of fungus disorders, and maybe dysentery, and of course malaria, and there were a lot of problems with them. But they handled it pretty well. They were always fun, and you know, not nasty, very nice, very respectful. So somebody gave me a kitten, and I would have the kitten on my desk in one of those wire baskets. And I went home for a weekend, and this fellow from Georgia, when I came back, he said he gave the kitten to his grandmother, which I thought was a big fat lie. And so I, being so sweet, I took his shoes away and his wallet, and that gave him a little time to consider the situation on the ward. He may still be on K5.
Like we were when we joined up.
Well, they're in the Navy now.
Lieutenant Eastridge, I was in the U.S. Navy in World War II. From the time I went into Farragut, Idaho for my training for 3 months, and I shipped out in San Pedro on the USS Hermitage. It was an Italian luxury liner, and we took it over during World War II. And I was on it for 3.5 years, traveling with the Queen Mary and the Queen Elizabeth to Europe. And incidentally, I went through the Panama Canal 7 times, and I was in 6 patellas of ships of over 150 from 1943 to 1945, when war broke out in Normandy. At that time, Eisenhower signed for the beginning of the invasion of Europe to stop the war over there. As for training, I went to NYA, National Youth Administration, to be a welder. And when they found out I was a certified welder at the time, they immediately wanted to sign me to that ship to be a welder. And I also had to take up fireman. I went to fireman school in New Jersey. And they also let us practice firing 20-millimeter guns at which we had aboard ship. So in other words, we could occupy different things aboard ship if called upon to do so. But my main object was aboard that ship was damage control. In case we was ever hit or torpedoed, if we could salvage or save the ship, we would weld sheet metal and anything that we could find to plug the hole. And my main concern was at that time was to be a welder to stop the sinking, but all during that time I welded throughout the ship anything that had to be put together, especially stainless steel around the kitchen. My first port was Wilmington, New Zealand. We got liberty at all these ports we went into. And in Australia, I was in Brisbane, Sydney, Melbourne. Well, I was almost in 6 ports in Australia alone. We got into a number of times, and then we went to an island, Bora Bora. It was a big fueling tank there for our ships and for our subs. And that was always the point of return there, because we always had to be fueled out there at that time to get fuel oil for the ship based there at Bora Bora. I was all through the Hebrides, through the Philippines, New Hebrides, New Caledonia, all islands, because on this troop transport, we could take 9,000 troops. So there's different times of nurses. There was different times that we would go into the islands where these men were needed at the time. And we always unloaded with we had the Navy ducks that they picked them up. And we never had no real port. The transport was so big that whenever we got into it, they let the troops out or whoever at the time. And we also picked up Navy nurses and waxed into Australia and into Brisbane a number of times, and into Sydney and Perth, free metals, Australia, a number of times all during that war. That was our turning point, always there. And these ships always had cruisers and battleships and destroyer escorts out in front. The oil tankers were always in the middle, of course, during the war. And it was quite a sight. We had to travel a half a mile and zigzag across either the Atlantic or Pacific at the time that we went in order to get away from the German subs. Well, I was in Britain a number of times, in England. I was in Le Havre, France, where they bombed. It was a German stronghold for the submarine pens there at the time. And the RAF and Americans bombed that severely. We never knew, they never told a ship at the time the secrecy of where these ships were traveling from point to point, wherever they picked up. And at one time in Australia, we picked up over 400 American brides that came back. And over in England, at France, we picked up a bunch of, we always picked up a bunch of war brides that were married and brought back to the United States during the war. In Bombay, India, we was in there Christmas Day. I went out to the Hanging Gardens, and I went to Taj Mahal. I seen Mahatma Gandhi, his speckled glass and bald-headed. And we had orders to come out of there. I think they was getting ready for the run at Normandy. And Umstead said, to hell with it. We're not waiting for the tugs to get out of here. So they went to take the ship out of the harbor, and we hit a big rock. And we bent the starboard side propeller, and we become instantly crippled. And so they took off most of the crew, and all officers but three, and we crippled clear back across the ocean at 10 knots. And they brought us into the Brooklyn Navy Yards and out of New York Harbor. And I remember at the time, one of the ships came up, either the Lexington or the Hornet, and they had over 200 men below decks, and they immediately told us to lay port side or starboard side and come to attention immediately because a warship was coming down the harbor with those men dead in the hull of that ship. And I never will forget that morning when they blew taps and that ship came down. And it came to alarming fact that we were in a killing war, and the Navy had a hell of a big time in winning that war. And the Kaiser told them, never let a troop carrier get across, because when they bring the boys over here, that makes the battle. And these ships were very vulnerable in World War II to make damn sure they'd sink them. We got a split in the ship, and it cracked, and it was underway. And so Singer come down. He said, "Hey," he said, "Yeah, that was a good one." He said, "Can you weld that?" I said, "Yeah, you know who I am." He said, "Yeah, you're Seaman First Class Eastern." He said, "What about it?" I said, "No, I'm the guy that can weld the cracker down and wheels on a miscarriage." He said, "Well, get busy and weld that crack." Well, we was underway, and I told him, I said, "I don't think we can do it." I said, "The only way we're going to do it is V it out and drill holes every 6 inches." You know, because the ship was under stress, and we was up in the North Atlantic, and waves were coming at us at 22 feet. And I said, "We get into calmer waters, we can do it." But I said, "We can never do it well, because the crack..." We stopped it when we drilled holes. We had these base drills, you know, magnetic base. So we had them drill, when we drilled the holes every 6 inches, and the plate was about 5/8 of an inch thick. So we drilled the holes, and then we got into calmer waters, and we held it for a while, and then we got into water, then it started cracking again. We didn't ever get it fixed until we got it back into Brooklyn Navy Yard. But that took place in aboard that ship, too, at the time. And then Singer wanted to know if I'd go down. There's another incident that took place. He wanted to know if I'd go down and do some welding for the the meat locker. So I get down there, and honest to God, here's horse meat, genuine horse meat, red horse meat. Senator came up and he said, you came down here for one damn purpose. You didn't see nothing. He said, all you got to do is weld them hooks and get your butt back out of here. He said, you never seen no horse meat. He said, what you saw was a steer from Nebraska, but you never seen no genuine horse meat hanging there.
The Army uses field wire extensively in combat areas and even in rear areas when time is limited. This is because field wire lines are less likely to become damaged and can be installed much more rapidly than other types of lines. Field wire is laid by various types of wire laying devices, known as reel units. The type used depends largely on the terrain and the length of the line to be laid. The different reel units require a varying number of men to operate them. The personnel required to operate one reel unit is known as a wire laying team.
Okay, my name is Isom. I'm known as Ike Ridgel. I'm today 90 years old. I was born in 1923 in a little town in southeast Alabama called Slocum, a very rural farm community. And that's where I lived the first 18 years. And during that time, that was my world. The furthest I went south was Panama City, and north Montgomery. That's the radius, about 100 miles. And when I graduated from high school, that was 1941, the Depression was still on. I guess the unemployment was around the range of 12-14%. So actually in my community, there was absolutely no opportunity for jobs, and I didn't have the financial resources to go to college. So I was over in the neighboring city of Dothan one day, and on the sidewalk was a big A-frame thing, join the Marines, we're looking for you, you know, that sort of thing. And it was in the post office. I went in and talked to the sergeant, and another guy was with me, my friend Gator Jones, and we came out of there, I'd say, pretty well sold. Maybe this is the answer. And so we went home. I talked to my mother and talked to my grandfather and friends, and it was a pretty big decision. And Gator was the same way, and so I, after all my consultation with friends and family, I got the feeling that was what I should do. And Gator came up and says his parents wouldn't permit him to go, and I actually think it was more him than it was his parents. But anyway, I signed up and got a ticket to go up to Birmingham, Alabama to get inducted in the Marine Corps. At that time, well, in the Marine Corps, normally on the eastern side, you go to boot camp at Parris Island, South Carolina. In some place, I think Mississippi River, someplace, the western, you go to San Diego. And it so happened, and I learned later how fortunate I was that it did happen this way, that Parris Island was full, so they said, we're going to have to send you to San Diego. And that's kind of like don't throw them in the briar patch type thing. And so I got on the train, and there's another recruit who just signed up. He was from Montgomery, and he was a little older. He was actually 2 years at Auburn, and he was a more worldly guy, much more than me. You know, I'd never been any place. This guy apparently had lived in a different
world than I did. So we became good friends, and he was sort of my mentor. And you know, we went out to San Diego to boot camp, first class on a Pullman train. You travel by train then, not airplane, buses. And man, that was big deal for me, you know, to go to the dining car three times a day. You know, we had chips to do that, and I didn't even know how to order. I'd never eaten in a restaurant my 18 years, one time. And so my buddy, his last name was Lyons. I can't remember. I always call him Lyons. Can't remember his first name. But it took several days to go out on the train, and a couple of days he was in the ROTC. He wore his ROTC uniform, and I was kind of impressed by that. And he told me, says, with my ROTC experience, he says, they'll probably make me a squad leader, and I'll get you in my squad, and I'll look out. I thought, man, that's great, you know, to get a good start like that. So we got to San Diego after a very interesting trip. My nose was into the window all the time. I didn't want to miss a thing, going across the Mississippi through the tunnels and they stops all along. And so they had big signs there, this direction for Marine recruits. And so they directed us to a little assembly place there, and by the trains were coming in from other parts of the country, and so we had to wait till they collected. Some other trains arrived, so we had, by the time it was ready to leave, there were two or three truckloads that took us out in these big 6x6 trucks. And the Marine base is not very far from the railroad station in San Diego. And we went through the gate, and looked around all this recruit depot, and golly, I'd never seen anything like it. It was all Spanish architect and very beautiful, you know, officers' homes, all that kind of stuff. And golly, you know, this is pretty nice. And they marshaled us into a big open room, and I might mention back at the recruit station in Dothan, and the encountering several Marines at the recruit office in Birmingham. They were all very polite, very friendly, and it was just a nice atmosphere. But when we got off that truck at boot camp, it was a new world. I never saw such a scumbags in my life. Get, you know, shape up. Stand up. Yes, sir. And no, you know, I mean, they really browbeat us and marched us in this place. He lined us up. An old sergeant sitting behind the desk, he had some papers. He looked down. He didn't even look at us, but we were lined up. He says, I'm going to ask you a question. And you, yes, sir, no, sir. Have you ever had any military experience? That was the question. So he went down the line, no, sir, no, sir. Three or four in the whole group, we must have had about 50. Yes, sir, how much? 3 years in the Army, sir. You come over here. Another one. 4 years in the Marine Corps, sir, re-enlisted. Come over here. They got my buddy Lyons, you know. Military experience? Yes, sir. How much? 2 years ROTC, sir. There's silence. He just got up. Well, sergeant got up, walked around, faced us. Who said that? Lyons, I did, sir. He went up front, he grabbed him and shook him. He used some words I won't use here. I didn't say Boy Scout, I said military. You ever had the military experience? No, sir. And so that was a shock to me. I felt so sorry for Lyons, and I was just trembling, I guess. I don't know. And when he came to me, he totally mispronounced my name. I wasn't sure it was me or not. And he repeated it more angrily than, you know, he was before, which I thought he was already angry. And I thought, that must be me, nobody else. So I answered, and it so happened that they split us, made two groups out of the group that was in the room, and Lyons and I were separated. So I never did see him again. I always wondered what happened. And let me say, in boot camp, you learn a lot of things, I think. In fact, my opinion, every high school graduate should go through some military boot camp. I think it couldn't hurt them, it would help them. But you learn discipline, you learn teamwork, you learn responsibility, and you just come out of, go in a boy, you come out a man. After graduation, you know, they read our assignments. I was assigned to, not to tanks, but field telephone school. I never heard of field telephone school. I didn't know, didn't even know it existed. But it turned out to be, that was a very good thing. The school was right there in the base, and we moved from tents. Then I moved into good quarters, and some of the barracks there, got to sleep on a real mattress, you know, in the boot camp, you're on a cot. And I did real well in field telephone school. I got a picture in there, I was the top guy in the class. And I should have been the top guy because my experience with a job in high school prepared me. I didn't know I was preparing for this, but back in the high school days, one of the jobs I had was working with an electrical contractor in my little town. He was not licensed. He was taking a correspondence course to get his license, and he had a little lab set up in his home where he studied these books and run these tests, and I was right with him on that. So when we came to field telephone school, as far as the electrical part, I knew it. I'd been through all that. And all I had to really learn new was the application of that to a combat unit. So anyway, we landed and coming into, you know, see Diamond Head. Everybody was excited about that. I'd heard about it. Didn't know anything about Hawaiian Islands, and heard of Honolulu and Pearl Harbor and Waikiki Beach. And so we got there, and I thought, it's going to be pretty good. I'll be stationed here in Honolulu. And that didn't turn out to be. They called us out, and about 25, there's a whole bunch of us new recruits on the ship going to Pearl Harbor. And they called us out for further assignments. And there's about, I guess, about 25 of us, and many of us had the same, you know, field telephone school, new recruit, all that. And so some of you are assigned to Midway, you're assigned to Wake Island, and I had no clue, you know, Midway, Wake, I was assigned to Midway. But let me jump back a minute. On the ship from San Diego to Pearl Harbor, it was very real crowded. They had an army and a lot of sailors going on for assignment. And it was really not very pleasant. There's so many on there. And at nights, the thing was all lit up. And the reason I'm mentioning that, I'll come to that in a minute. But so we got on this ship, and the next ship was more of a Navy ship, and there's only about 25 Marines on there. And the itinerary was to go to Wake Island first and drop those guys off. Then if you look at Pearl Harbor and Wake and Midway, it's kind of a triangle. You go a greater distance to Wake Island, and there's no harbor at Wake Island. And they brought a barge out and unloaded a lot of supplies, and about half our group, 10 or 12 guys, I guess, got off at Wake Island. Now, remember, this is sometime in October. And on December 7th, you know, Wake was attacked like Pearl Harbor and like Midway. And then the guys on Wake were either killed or captured in December. December 13th, 1941, the Japs made their first assault on the, trying to capture Wake, and the guys repulsed that assault. The Japanese were defeated, and that was the only time, I think, in Pacific War where a landing force was repulsed. But the Japs went back and regrouped and brought in much more ships and guns and people and captured Wake around, I think it was around Christmas 1941. So anyway, of course we didn't know that at the time, but we dropped the guys off. Then we went to Midway, and that's where our crew dropped off. Now Midway is, there is a harbor there's a dock. Midway is has two islands, the main island, Sand Island, Eastern Island, and Coral, and there's a big lagoon there. And so my home for the next about 17 months was Midway. And I didn't know that. I thought we'd be there about 6 months or so. And I was assigned to the 6th Defense Battalion. And defense is a key word here I'll bring up later. And we, our job was to defend Midway in case of attack. And life on Midway was, we first went into Quonset huts. There are about 15 or 20 Marines in there. And in the meantime, well, let me go back. Midway has no natives. I mean, the natives are goonie birds. If you ever heard of a goonie bird, they're goonie. And, but they did have about, I don't know, several hundred contractors building fortifications, pillboxes, bunkers, and they were building some nice barracks. And the barracks were almost complete. And we thought we were going to get out of the Quonset huts, we're going into the new barracks. Well, also, they were building bunkers. I mean, kind of on the style of a submarine, you come in aisle and you got bunks on either side, and you got an L-shaped entrance so a shell can't come in directly. And we didn't get to go in the barracks. And this is before the war. We moved into the to the bunkers. And by the way, that's where we lived my entire time, rest of the 17 months in those bunkers. And they put us to work. We were field telephone, some of us guys there. But in a situation like Midway, there weren't many Marines there, and you had to do a whole bunch of other stuff. And we got involved. You had to string barbed wire along the fence. Let me say that the atmosphere then was getting ready for war. We didn't, or I didn't realize what was happening in the diplomatic world. You know, it was things were breaking down. And just to give you an example of that, by the way, Midway was an overnight stop for the China Clipper. I don't know if you know what the China Clipper, you know, that was, if you, the only way to get to the Far East at that time was by a slow boat, steamer, or they came into the China Clipper. That's a, well, in military terms, it'd be a PBY, but it's a, water, you know, you land on the water. And Midway and was an overnight stop. They had a little hotel there. It was by Pan American. And so the plane would land, and they'd bring the passengers into the little hotel on Midway, and they'd same thing on day Wake. And then next day, they'd take them out to the lagoon. They'd take off for China or Manila. And on one of these days in November, the Japanese sent their one of their top diplomats, I think his name was Crusoe, to Washington for peace. They had the ambassador in Washington, but this was a a higher level guy, I would say, than the Bastard, because he just came from Tokyo and he knew, you know, what the top guys were thinking. And so they were negotiating with our Secretary of State at that time, I believe it was Cordell Hull, and they were negotiating, talking peace. At the same time, the Japanese were dropping bombs on Pearl Harbor. I'm a little ahead of myself now, but and if you go back and look at history now, we were headed for war. Of course, we didn't realize it, but fortunately, some of our commanders did, maybe not the high up, but the guys, our little detachment garrison at Midway was Lieutenant Colonel Shannon, very good man. He was the commanding officer, but the overall command was a Navy commander named Captain Smart. I mentioned we were doing all kind of things. We were laying all kind of telephone lines out to pillboxes and putting landmines on the beach. And on December 7th, now this is, I'm going to talk about some embarrassing moments for me, but we had our command post at a little field telephone switchboard. It's about that long, not that high, and it's just like, the Andy Griffith Show, where, what's her name, Sarah's plugging in the, you get a call, a little thing flaps down, you take that and you plug it in to whoever who they want to talk to. And I'd operated the switchboard several times, but there's always a senior guy there. In fact, our contingent there, we had some really old salt Marines. We're all privates then, and my immediate was the Corporal Hutchinson. He's a big redhead guy out of Oklahoma, and then Master Sergeant Haley. Hutch was the corporal. Haley was a big handlebar mustache from Texas. And some of those old guys had served in China, and golly, some of the wild tales they told. But anyway, on Sunday morning, December 7th, I was assigned a switchboard for the first time alone. I knew how to operate it technically as much as anybody, and I guess I figured Sunday morning, it's quiet, and so let the new recruit give us a chance to sleep in, the senior guys. And we'd been told, there's a little red tab up there, that's Colonel Shannon. And I sort of got the impression he'll call you. You don't mess with him. I hadn't been long out of boot camp, and to me, a sergeant was a big guy, and Lieutenant Colonel was just beyond anything I could conceive of talking to. And I got a call from the officer of the day. You know, the officer of the day is kind of like a guy in charge that day. If anything unusual happens, he has to judge, does that go up to the colonel or I'll handle it. And so he says, connect me to Colonel Shannon. I stumble around, sir, I don't know what I've done. I'm not supposed to do that. He's not supposed to do that. And I didn't really know who this officer day was anyway. And he says, the Japs have bombed Oahu. Well, now here's where my stupidity comes in. See, you know, Oahu is the island for Pearl Harbor and Honolulu, five big islands off. And I'd seen Oahu in print, but we'd always talked about Honolulu and Pearl Harbor. We never did talk about Oahu. And it didn't ring a bell with me that he was talking about Hawaiian Islands. I thought he was talking about some place in the Dutch East Indies, and the Japs were very active over there. You know, they were expanding their empire at a tremendous rate in China, Manchuria and Dutch East Indies, and Formosa at that time. And So I still was trying to, you know, I didn't want to get in trouble for waking Colonel Shannon up. I figured I'd get in trouble there, and I was, you know, in a tight spot. And he really got calling me something, I don't, the name I want. He says, "The Japs have bombed Pearl Harbor, you so-and-so, connect me." And when he said Pearl Harbor, that registered that Pearl Harbor is between me and home, you know, it's back that way. And the Japs are supposed to be this way. And so I connected him to Colonel Shannon. And so we went into, I guess, full alert from that. We'd been working day and night, you know, building fortifications. We were all out of our barracks, I mean, all underground. And that night, we lived in blackouts all the time. We never had any surface lights. And we was in our dugout, we heard some boom, boom. And that was unusual. So me and my buddy, Mort Harkins, we went out to see what we could see. And we got out, there's Scavoli bushes just covers Midway. And we really couldn't see over them, but we could see a flash down by our hangar. This was a seaplane hangar, and see a flash out in the ocean. And we finally realized, you know, we had some Japs out there. And I thought, with the flash on ours down by the hangar was our guns, and the flashes we saw out there was our shells hitting their ships. And the old gunny sergeant came, we had a path through the bushes. He came charging through there. He was about out of breath. And meantime, me and Harkins had climbed up on a big sand dune that the bulldozers had pushed up, getting ready to make another bunker right near us beside. And there's a whole bunch of rebar, you know what I'm talking about, rebar, laying out there. And the old gunny came along. I said, "We're giving hell, ain't we, gunny?" And he looked up and saw me and Harkin. Said, "You stupid SOBs." He said, "We ain't fired a shot." What we were seeing, at that time, I didn't understand incoming from outgoing. It was their guns, and the flashes down by the hangar was hitting the hangar. He said, "Follow me," you know, and so we went on, got our stations, you know, where we were supposed to be during the attack. And our guns did finally open up, and I don't know if they ever determined, I think there was all kind of theories where there were two or four ships, but I'm talking about the night, you know, they hit Pearl Harbor in the morning and hit us that night. And our guns opened up, their ships took off, and I don't know why we didn't spot the ships during the day, because we had these seaplanes, BBY, that was making the circle, maybe overcast or what, I don't know, but it was a complete surprise. And you know, that got us on full alert. I think we're already on full alert. And so this was December 7, 1941, and everything was quiet then for a while. I think a submarine, maybe or two, would surface, lob a couple of shells, and then die before our guns could get trained on them. But they never did do any damage, and I never knew of anyone that got hurt by them. But the next big event was sometime in, I think, late May. And by the way, we were getting some reinforcements. In fact, Admiral Nimitz, he was the top guy in the Central Pacific. You know, we went to Japan with Nimitz in charge of the Central Pacific and MacArthur coming around by, you know, the Philippines to Japan. And Nimitz came out, and I learned this later, he asked Colonel Shannon, "What does it take to for you to hold Midway because, by the way, you know, they captured Wake in late in around Christmas. And so Midway at that time, we were the furthest point flying the American flag to Tokyo. And so it was obvious that was maybe a prize target for the Japanese. And Nimitz came out he talked with Colonel Shannon. They did send some reinforcements out. We didn't have any tanks, as I recall. We got four tanks and got some of the guys from the Raider Battalion. And something was going on, fortunately, that we weren't aware of, and I'm sure you are, that we had broken the Japanese naval code. And these are some guys working out of Honolulu. And it's an interesting story if you read about that, because there's a lot of conflict between what those guys were doing and what they were doing in Washington. And they broke the code, and the Japanese had a big plan for invading a target they called AF. Our code, have you heard this story? Okay, AF was the destination that Japanese, when they pick up the code, they were getting troops here, they were getting supplies and all, aircraft carriers together to go capture AF. Now our problem was, they didn't know where AF was, we didn't. They just called it AF. We'd broken the code, but some of the top authorities thought it was Honolulu, they were going there, and some thought it was the Aleutian Islands, and the guys in the place in Pearl Harbor thought it was Midway. And the guys in Washington, no, you guys don't know what you're talking about. It's Aleutian Islands or so. And so one, I think he's a lieutenant, got the clever idea. And he said, let's send out a message over the open wire. And the message says, the distillation plant at Midway is out. There's only 2 weeks of water supply. There's no natural water on Midway. All of our water was desalination. And so they waited. They picked up a message, Japanese. The desalination plant at AF is down. AF only has 2 weeks of water. So they knew it was Midway. Because the dilemma that Nimitz faced, let me go back a little bit. When they hit Pearl Harbor, Japanese, there's two big things in our favor that saved me. I wouldn't be here today, or the war might still be going. There were no aircraft carriers in the harbor at Midway. You know, the Japanese destroyed everything in there. Fortunately, we only had, I think, four aircraft carriers at that time. The Yorktown was in the Atlantic at that time on Pearl Harbor. And the Lexington, one of them was taking some reinforcement marine planes to Wake Island. This I'm talking about now, before they captured. And there was another carrier that, I don't remember, it was Hornet or Saratoga. One of them was returning from taking some reinforcement planes to Midway. We had received some marine dive bombers and torpedo bombers. And so all the aircraft carriers were out of Pearl Harbor. And so the Japanese didn't know, or they probably would have waited till they were in. And another thing the Japanese missed, there was a huge fuel tank farm on Oahu. And they didn't hit that. If they'd have destroyed that, our ships could never leave. I mean, we couldn't supply. So the dilemma Nimitz was in before he knew AF was Midway, should he position his carriers, his three that was available, see, Yorktown was Atlantic, up at Lucian's, or some thought he was maybe coming down to the Carolina Islands. And so when he got the word it was AF, he knew what, he put the carriers up northwest of Midway. And so back on the island Midway now. They called us out in formation sometime in late, I don't remember the date, late May, and said the Japanese are coming to attack Midway, and they told us the name of the ships, the commanders, where they're loading the troops. Ironically, they were loading some troops from Saipan to come to capture Midway. I say ironic because later on, I'd be in the group that went to capture Saipan. And it was pretty hot. I mean, the Japanese, Saipan was ideally, like Iwo was, a terrain that was suitable for defense. Mount Tapajo was 1,500 feet. They had caves, coverage. And I saw some of this on that return trip I made last year. I didn't realize they had that many guns. I don't know. I'd probably turn around and went the other way if I could. But anyway, we landed, and there was tractors, Amtraks, and Higgins boats. They were just destroyed all along the beach there, and we didn't get far in. And my best buddy during the war that just unfortunately passed away a few months ago, a guy named Jerry Foley from Vermont. And so we didn't, as far as setting up our communications switchboard and lines, we didn't do anything the first day because we didn't know where anybody was. There's no saying in war that your plans, everything works beautiful until the first shot is fired. Then throw them plans away. And that's sort of the way it is. We didn't know where any, in fact, we had trouble getting our own, finding our own group together to get organized to start. But when dark came, there was stuff coming in all during the day. And in fact, when we were going in, you could see water spouts all over where they were trying to hit the boats before they came in. And so me and Foley, and we always did from there after, we dug a two-man foxhole for that night. And again, I'll go back to the rumors. Rumors were that after dark, the Japanese were getting in some small boats down on the other end of the island. They were coming around behind us. And so we thought, we got to watch this way, we got to watch this way. And as far as I know, that never did happen. If it did, if they started, I guess the Navy took care of them, but we never did have anybody coming in behind us. But the shelling was heavy, mortars and artillery that night. And, you know, as I said, the ground would shake, there'd be a lull. And you think, oh, golly, just let this be. And about that time, pop. Altitude, one of the star shells, you know, a star shell is, it opens up at altitude and with a big flare light, when drift down with a parachute and just lights the whole area. So when you know that, you just brace yourself because stuff's coming in. And one of the things that disheartening, however how you want to call it, in that situation is you can't do anything. You just sit there. You can't fight back. You can't do anything. And you just hope for daylight so our spotter planes and get our aircraft, you know, to knock those things out. So we got organized the next day, and we started running our lines out to the combat units. And the biggest problem then was to find the location of, you know, the unit that you're supposed to run a line. And on Saipan, the landing force was the 2nd and 4th Division. And the reinforcements was the 27th Army Division. And the Army was in reserve, but things got pretty tough in on Saipan, and so the reserve 27th Division came in, and they were actually put in one of the toughest spots in the island. And we were, my crew was to go to lay a line to their command post, and the way we operated, our wire platoon was, I was a sergeant then, and you'd take a crew out, usually three or four, could be more depending on how far it was and what the conditions were and all. And normally, again, depending on how far it was, what the terrain, what the situation was, sometimes it would be you had to walk all the way carrying your wire. And other times you could go so far in a Jeep and then do the rest as far as you thought it was safe. Then you do the rest by the walking. So we started out in the Jeep on this mission, and sometimes your maps are, you think where people are, that ain't where they are. And it sure happened in this case. We thought we could go a certain distance in the Jeep safely, but we rounded a little knoll and going down a little incline, and we saw a bunch of soldiers in a ravine there, kind of a ravine. It was sloping the way we, but the opposite wall was sort of vertical. So what we would do normally is we'd go along and see some guys, what unit you're in. Now our Marine units, we always had an emblem on the back, the numbers that identified the unit, and we knew those, so we could tell if we were looking for 24th Regiment, we knew their sign, but the Army we didn't know, so we thought, well, we better stop and ask these guys. So we stopped the Jeep. There was several of us on the Jeep. The driver, I was by the driver's side. We had a guy on the hood and had a couple of guys in the back. And we were hanging all over that. And they started yelling at us. They were sitting hunkered down. And there was nothing coming in that particular second. They yelled, get that Jeep out of here. Get that, you know, they were using all kinds. You're going to draw fire. Jap's right up there. And we thought, you know, them Army guys, they're a little skittish. They're new here, and we're old veteran Marines. that's sort of the way we were thinking. And so we're looking for the command post of so-and-so. I said, it's right under that bridge there, but you better get that Jeep out of here. You're going to draw fire. And we said, well, we put this telephone in, and we'll... And about the time they said that, kawam, something hit right near us, and we hit the ground, and some more came over us and all around us, and I hit the ground, and I was looking the way I fell. I could look up the slight hill there. A lot of it was tree-covered bushes, but there was one section kind of clear. And there was a Jap tank up there, and I could see the smoke and kawam. And there was another one, I couldn't see it, but I could see the puff of smoke at the edge of the bushes. And that was, you know, those guys knew what they were talking about. All of a sudden it stopped, the tank went back in. I guess they feared maybe we had a spotter aircraft or something, I don't know, that scared them back in, but it was quiet. And but in the meantime, when it hit, the driver was still in, JP tried to turn it around, and he ran into a ditch and stalled it. But the rest of us just flat on the ground. So after it stopped, and we then went over to the, in the cover of the ravine where the soldiers were, and kind of took stock of anybody hurt, and we, nobody was hurt, and somebody looked on the back of one of our guys, Sergeant Steve Janoski. Yeah. Steve had a pretty big chest, so his jacket was pretty tight, and he had a cut in his jacket about that long, from shoulder or down to the hip. He went over and pulled up his jacket, and he had a thin red mark, no blood, just thin red mark about that long where a piece of shrapnel. It's just amazing, you know, how close it was. That, you know, just could have torn him up, but that was the worst thing we got. But I guess those soldiers probably got a life out of that after we after we left. Let me go. You know, the more, the older you get, the more you think, the more how senseless war is. Let me go back to Roy Namor for a moment. Comes to mind. The final battle there, I guess you, or I don't know where you call it, battle or what, but you know, it was obvious they had lost. And they got full of psyche, I guess, on that last night. And you know, they made a bonsai charge. And our guys, our command post behind that, so we could hear some yelling up there, but it really wasn't on the front. Our machine gunners, BAR, you know, the Brown automatic rifle, and riflemen they came as just a mob. No military, I don't know how to say it, just a mob. And went out the next morning, looked at just dead Japs all over the place. And some of them didn't even have a gun. They had a bamboo pole with a kitchen knife strapped to it. I mean, that's how stupid it was. And toward the end of Saipan, you know, they did a similar thing. And there's a end of the island where we were kept pushing them back. It was a place called Marpy Point. And it's sort of a high cliff, I guess a couple of hundred feet drop down. And we had Japanese interpreters that would be on the foghorns, you know, the speakers trying to tell them to come out, we'll take care of you medically, food, we're not going to harm you. And that was the Samaros. There were natives, the first natives we encountered were on Saipan, Samaros, good people. But the Japanese had brainwashed the people. There were Japanese on the natives, on many of them on Saipan. And they had brainwashed them into, it's better to commit suicide than it is to be captured by the Americans. And, you know, in fact, in Japanese, kind of like the Muslim, you're disowned. If you're captured, you're a nobody. We don't recognize, you're not a, so that was the biggest disgrace. So the Japanese always, you know, are ready to commit harakiri, and that was one of the big concerns about if you had to land on Japan, you face all those people that are, just life means nothing to them. I mean, they'd rather die than to surrender.
Received this afternoon a message from the Japanese government in reply to the message forwarded to that government by the Secretary of State on August 11th. I deem this reply a full acceptance of the Potsdam Declaration, which specifies the unconditional surrender of Japan. In the reply, there is no qualification. Arrangements are now being made for the formal signing of the surrender terms at the earliest possible moment. General Douglas MacArthur has been appointed the Supreme Allied Commander to receive the Japanese surrender. Great Britain, Russia, and China will be represented by high-ranking officers. Meantime, the Allied armed forces have been ordered to suspend offensive action. The proclamation of VJ Day must await upon the formal signing of the surrender terms by Japan.
With a love that's true, always. When the things you've planned need a helping hand.
He came into my ward at the Naval Medical Center in Bethesda, Maryland, and he was a sick Marine. He was feeling the effects of malaria, and they were doing a lot of research there on tropical diseases, malaria, schistosomiasis, several others. And so the group was looking at a movie. It was almost finished, so I couldn't stop the movie to interview him, so I told him to sit down for a few minutes till the movie was over. It would have disrupted everything, you know, to get them all back in again for the movie. So that's how it started. And then he was there for a while. He'd come from Quantico. And then he had leave, went to Binghamton for his week's leave, whatever it was. And one of the boys on the ward told him that he better get back, because I was dating someone else if he was really interested. So he did, he came back. I think it was too cold in Binghamton anyway. So and I didn't think much of anything. I just thought he was another patient, and he was sick, and you know. And after a while, when he came, I guess we dated a little bit before he went on leave, and then when he came back, we dated again, I guess. I guess it was about, about a year later that we were married?
Yeah.
It was about a year later.
Well, again, she left out a little of the background. I heard about this research program when I was at Quantico, so I waited until I got a bad case of malaria. So, matter of fact, they really carried me in an ambulance from the train station to the National Naval Medical Center, and that's where I checked in. And it was after I got on duty, I turned in one night on a relapse. I guess maybe you weren't on the ward when I first was admitted to the hospital, but she was on duty the night I checked in with this bad case of malaria. I'd been standing guard, so I told her, you know, she said, just sit over there till the movie's over. Anyway, and I did, and I got admitted again that night. Now, the overall program, if we volunteered to be a research patient, they gave us an extra 30 days off leave. And so all of us put in about a year of research. We're gambling they wouldn't do anything bad, we'd die or anything, but we lived through it. And in the meantime, we met some of these lovely girls, waves and nurses, and in particular, they say I'm a leg man. Anyway, these girls with the white stockings was very attractive. Anyway, I was attracted to Eb, and after I got admitted that night, after being on duty, then I was a regular patient on the ward for quite a while. And in the course of all that, you know, you ask these girls, you know, women in the Pacific for 3 years, and asked them, try to get a date with a nurse. That was pretty good for a Marine, you know. Actually, they're an officer and I'm an enlisted man, and really it's not supposed to be part of the way you do business in the officer corps. But anyway, we did. And we had a lot of fun, a lot of dates, and then And all of a sudden, I was through the program and I got discharged. And that's when I went home to Binghamton. And as I told you, I was trying to figure out whether I was going to get settled, go to college, what to do under the GI Bill and the VA. And when Maggie, Philip Manganello, who called me up, he later became the proprietor of Maggie's Restaurants in Washington, D.C. Redskins were his big customers, Redskins. Anyway, he called me up and told me the story. She's dating Joe Brault and want to get your butt down here if you're serious about this. So again, I talked to my family. I had interviewed Mr. Peck at the gas company, and he told me I had to get an undergraduate degree, and then he'd get me an MIT, and then I could go through Columbia Gas and Electric. But I had to get an AB first. So then, after Maggie called, I thought, well, George Washington University and the nation's capital have a lot of programs, and maybe I get a part-time job in the government and go to school part-time and resume my courtship with Ev and all that kind of thing. So actually I did. I had about $50 in my pocket when I hitchhiked back to Washington. I put up for a while in the Marine barracks on the campus, which wasn't quite kosher, but I had to have some place to go. Anyway, I resumed our courtship, and I finally found an apartment, one-room apartment in Bethesda. She let me play the piano, so that was nice. And I got my first job. I worked out with the university, a deal where I could go to school 5 nights a week and Saturdays year-round and keep pace with the day student. And I did that and worked full-time. Got my first job with the United States Public Health Service, and within the first year with the National Institutes of Health, which, as you know, today was shut down on account of the shutdown. Anyway, at the NIH, that's where my career really blossomed. And concurrently with my GI training, at nights, working days, it was really a neat deal. But anyway, it was in the course of making that arrangement, my first job, I got my, then I did propose, and I'm not sure whether you were ever accepted or not. But anyway, we did make a deal.
Think it over.
At that time, I had a full-time job with the NIH, and the big thing with her was, you know, if Navy nurses got married, they had to get out of the Corps. So she meant she was giving up her Navy career to marry this.
That was just for a 2-year period, too.
Yeah.
And after that, you stayed. That was the only time they did that.
Yeah.
And you can stay in, have 20 kids.
Yeah. So anyway, we did that. We got married in the Naval Chapel at the Naval Hospital, and there's one picture someplace. I've never seen so many nurses in one room in my life. All of her comrades came to the wedding, just a few civilians. Anyway, it was really a neat wedding, and we had it at the chapel at the Naval Medical Center, and then we had a gorgeous honeymoon. We used all of her terminal leave and what savings I had from the Marine Corps, and we went to the cloister, Sea Island, Georgia. That's one way to start a honeymoon, is they go first class. Then we come back, and we had to start room, a new life all over again, and a furnished room in Chevy Chase, Maryland. It overlooked a tennis court. That was nice. And we shared a bathroom in the hall, and that was welcome to married life. But within a few months, we got our first apartment, which was a two-room bungalow, two-room cottage in Bethesda, and that was very nice.
The landlady, though, she would come up and rearrange the furniture.
She lived in a basement apartment, and she had a key. And a little disconcerting. You come home from work and find the furniture all rearranged because it's the way she wanted it. No, we were renting it out. Anyway, we had a delightful time there, and some great experiences. And so anyway, I fell in love with her as my nurse, and it's nice that she married a sick Marine, and we've lived 67 years ever after.
Not be fair, oh.
That's when I'll be there always. Not for just an hour, not for just a day, not for just a year, but always.